is completely informal, and the purpose is to bring together people who normally not be in the same room. So it's probably a matter of ecumenicism, right? So, and by the way, for lack of anyone else, I became a specialist on finding Islamic specialists, which I know nothing about, except that it's a very good and dynamic literature, to bring it together with other good and dynamic literatures. And I think the intellectual reason behind it, which has a lot to do with Nadieszda and the way she's been approaching religion, is to take stock of where we stand now as a field, and I think there have been some very good changes, which is that we've tended to look at religion as a matter of minority identities in the Russian Empire, for the most part, against a dominant religion, which is Orthodoxy, and we have a much more nuanced understanding of how religion might operate, both as a mass movement in the late empire, and as a form of governance, also in the late empire. And these are the two tracks, I think, that have been developed very well in recent years. And I think we've been helped by the fact that we're more in conversation with people outside of the Russian field. We're no longer the field we used to be. We used to be able to say, I think, as a Russian field more generally, that that we owe nothing to anybody because we're funded directly by the State Department and the Department of Justice. I'm not joking. And as long as that money was coming through, we owe no explanation to anyone else. And so when I was trained at Columbia, with Nadia, by the way, and with Chuck, any other Columbia folks here, we were at what was considered to be at the time the preeminent Russian Studies Center. And we were told specifically, don't bother with the comparisons. Do not bother with the. And so we didn't at the time. But over time, we began to talk among ourselves. So we didn't collapse, and then we began to dry up. And we felt that we had to justify ourselves in different ways. And I think, we're coerced into it. I think the results have been very good. The results have been seen around the table, and also in the interventions of people outside the field have been making. Religion less as a matter of identity, and religion much more as a matter of politics, mass politics, and government. If you don't know most of the people around the table, I think that's good news, because we'd like to understand that there are many things happening in the other subfields, and to sort of break out of our very narrow confines. I am particularly delighted because I'm not a specialist in religion at all, in any way. Other than my private life, but as a scholar, I haven't looked into it at all. But we've had other people who have, and with us now is Karen Weber, who recently defended a PhD at Columbia on at NYU. I'm thinking genealogically. So
Columbia is also a good school.
on Lutheranism, and there's a lot to be said about that too, and the way it ties in with governance and with the state. That's all I have to say. I wanted to thank David, he was your Gennady Estraikh. You're the chair this year, right?
For my sins.
And Nadia, who's, as you know, a native New Yorker. for helping organize, and also to the Kevorkian Center. We're in the Kevorkian Center, if you haven't realized. It's trying to make an architectural point. Space is at a premium at NYU, so we're happy to have it. We're going to try to seize it. The Jordan Center needs the space like this. I represent the Jordan Center, which is a new center. We're in a second year now. We're bringing together all aspects of the study and promotion of knowledge of Russia, but not necessarily promoting Russia. but knowledge of Russia. I'll leave it at that. There's nothing else to say. The point is really to have a conversation. That's why we're trying to keep comments down, the introductory comments for each of the panelists, to about 10 minutes, thereabouts. I think people should feel free to jump in right at the end of somebody's presentation and ask some small follow-up questions. Same thing with the next ones, and then have a general conversation. There's a lot to be said out there. First panel.
Can we just somewhere on the moon?
Of course, please. So, I'm Yanni Kotsonis. I'm in the history department at NYU, and I'm at the Jordan Center for the study of Russia.
Bilengo, I am, as you've heard, chair of Hebrew and Jewish Studies, right next door.
I'm Chuck Steinmetal. I'm in the history department at NEIU, which is Northeastern Illinois University in Chicago.
I'm Yelena Campbell. I'm from St. Petersburg, but now I'm teaching Imperial Russian history at the University of Washington.
Hi, I'm Jan Frolik. I'm a second year in the History and Hebrew Judaic Studies program here at NYU.
I can't remember. I just suspended.
A Polonist, not usually honored to be invited into a company of Russians as such. I'm happy with East because everything further East isn't in New York anymore. So I'm at the University of Michigan.
Gennady Estraikh, I'm also from the Department of Kieval to the Studies, and I didn't mainly believe this, but I understand Russian as well.
I'm Bob Weinberg, a teacher at Swarthmore College, and I've been working on the Beilis case for the last few years.
And your book is coming out as
well? My book should be out by the triple, well, whatever it's called, the triple journalist. And just to let people know, when I lived here many, many, many years ago, I paid $120 a month for my apartment.
That's always a point of pride.
I was younger than this.
I'm Hillel, Kieval, and I teach European Jewish history, Central and Eastern Europe, Hofstra lines at Washington University in St. Louis. And I also chair a unusual department called Jewish, Islamic, and Near Eastern Languages and Cultures, which actually brings a variety of tracks into a conversation with
one another. I'm Nadieszda, Kizenko. I teach Russian history, European history at the University of Albany, just a few miles upstate. And I'm actually now finishing a book about confession in the Russian Empire from the point at which czars start thinking it's a good idea in 1666 to the present. And have hilarious stories about Jews and Muslims who convert to Orthodoxy and then decide it wasn't such a good idea. And how they found out.
What is that? Ziva, did you want to?
I'm Ziva Galili. I'm a Russian historian teaching at Rutgers for a while now at NYU. And in recent years, I've been dabbling in aspect of Jewish Russian.
I'm Sam Casper. I'm a PhD candidate in Soviet history in Michigan, Pennsylvania.
I'm Nicole Bissou. I'm a second year master's student in journalism and Russian and Slavic studies.
I'm Adrian Karkinski. I'm an interloper. So. Or I could say I'm a spouse and you can figure out which of the 20 people.
As our very special guest, we have Marsha Campbell. Marsha Campbell, who's going to be very patient with us.
She's my guy.
So moving right on, we have three panelists now. I was going to say, you work with Bob, you said you're not running, right?
I'm not here for the
right. So we can begin with the chair, with Gennady.
So 10 minutes here.
10 minutes would be great.
Because that text is, of course, longer, and
Bob Sarus has just entered the room.
Sorry. And I'm Albany, if you like, also. Every day. Maybe they could have a quarter of a million on Sunday. 300,000 copies published in 10 city editions and 2 printing shops in New York and Chicago. So it was quite a monster. It was an empire, and I believe that to a significant degree this was a newspaper that was shaping the American mainstream. The American mainstream in many ways. The editor of the newspaper, and the other day I was at the presentation of a new book about him, Abe Kahn, was quite a strange person. Strange and very interesting person. He was, on the one hand, he was Jewish, and he always remained proudly Jewish. On the other hand, he was a socialist, and it's very difficult to define his socialism, because it was the socialism of Abe Kahn. You know, it wasn't the Bund, it wasn't something else, it was his own socialism, and shared by some other people. And also, he was in love with Russian language, Russian culture, and hated Russia. That was a normal combination. So his love to Russia was, I don't remember what he loved and what his wife loved. They always argued he was arguing for Tolstoy and she was for Chekhov, and they couldn't find a common denominator. But they spoke from Russian at home. She translated some of his writings into Russian, and actually he even wrote in Russian. I came across his letters, still written with his yacht, you know, till the end of his life was yacht. And but the combination was somehow, it was difficult for him to do it, to be in love and to hate it. And I quote here in one of his books, he wrote that, and it also was he wrote in English, and he was very comfortable in English, and he started, he opened a textbook of English when he was on his way to the United States, and by that time he was 22, and he ended up being a writer in English, a journalist in English. And he wrote in one of his books, I love the Russian people as much as I ever did. I don't think that the Russians themselves are capable of loving their people as I do, but I can't be helped. It is a personal divide between us. So this was this divide, and this divide, of course, every time we get a new some topics or a new some events that would bring into the divide and to this permanent perennial criticism of Russia. 1913 was the year when the newspaper discussed first the 300 years of the Roman times. And it was full of articles on this topic, and I can give you a couple of titles. Nikolai's Pedigree, and that was the role that he wasn't there, actually Russian. David Jones, and then the entire story of this family there. And then there was another topic of this. Another article with such a quiet title, Russians Good for Nothing, Tsars and Tsarinas. And so on, that they always call another article, the Romanovs 300 Bloody Years. So they were always updated about this, and I'll quote a couple of phrases from this article, The Bloody Years. Hand in hand with the Russian Orthodox Church, the Romanov dynasty has for 300 years never stopped building a great big wall around Russia in order to shield the country from sun, warmness, and happiness. and they added, of course, that now we have at last a group of people and humanity was revolutionaries. And there were strong links between them and socialists in Russia. It was a permanent fundraising for the Russian revolutionary movement. The organization that was a sister organization to the forwards, Albany, workman's circle members would pay an additional contribution every month to help the revolutionary movement in Russia. So this would be sort of for so they emphasized that the fact that there were forces ready to ruin this war. In the center of my presentation here, or in the text that I wrote, there is a person whose name was Moshe Olgin. His real name was, of course, Olgin, and I came across once a story that I don't know where to believe or not, that he was was in love with a girl from the circle of Western Ukraine, the Ukrainian writer. It is difficult to understand from the story that this whole was Russian, she was Ukrainian, she was Jewish, and she died. And as a result, he carried this letter. His family life is a separate story. He lived in Menage Atirav, an anarchist and an artist here in New York, Nina Kotsonis, and an Italian anarchist. But at that time, he was the foremost journalist who is prominent in Eastern Europe. And he spent some time in Kiev during the trial and wrote about. So the combination of the coverage was Moshe Olgin's articles. And he was also a writer. He studied at the Kiev University, then the Heidelberg University, then his PhD was from the Columbia University. So he was extremely well educated person. He was a writer, wrote the first literary novel in Yiddish, and person of many. And later he became one of the leaders of the communist movement here in the United States, and the editor of the communist newspaper Friday, till the very last day of his life in 1939. So he wrote articles, and the articles actually, they use this term, phony land. In English, there's such a term, phony or a phony land. And phony comes, of course, from the Russian aphonia. Or Phanasia, whatever, it became a generic and very negative term. And it's interesting that they weren't ashamed to put it, because it was an in language. At that time, it was an in language, of course, it wasn't the period of time of political characters. Anyway, so they wrote about this foreign land, and the coverage of the Beilis process was the following. I'll give you just a few main points. The main point was that Russia wasn't just one society, one country, two components. One component was progressive, another component was conservative, and essentially, and this conservative, this element was trying to raise this issue of the blood libel. They also, in the article, so we can read that, of course, it was organized, mainly it was organized, actually, by this Black Hundred groups in order to create a case. And the case was important if we read and read the articles, because at that time the Russian Duma discussed a bill, an idea of a bill about the abolition of the federal Jews. So in order to do something with this bill, how historical was it? And but they always emphasized the progressive part of Russia. They emphasized that on the eve of the trial itself, not the whole case, but on the trial itself, there was strikes all over the country, strikes of solidarity. And strikes, the geography of the strikes is really impressive. It's Warsaw, Vilna, St. Petersburg, Minsk, Grodno, Kovno, Brest, Babluisk, Slony, and some small gone strikes, socialist groups wanted to show that they were against this whole case. Well, it was also important that we find in that, that on the same day, all secondary schools in Kiev were closed. Students also organized a strike. And they emphasized that according to this sentence now, only up to 5% of students were Jewish. So this Kiev that has this reputation, I believe it's a long reputation, of the most anti-Semitic city in the country, was, students, pupils were actually in this mode of solidarity.
The gymnasium.
The gymnasium. I don't understand that. Gymnasium. Also, and of course, when they got this information about the end product of the trial, Abe Kahn and other journalists praised the Russian people, the peasants. They were still in this Narodnik idea with this hundreds of cases, examples, when peasants would afterwards come to Jews and go, forgive us, please, it's the city guys who triggered this. Of course, they emphasized also that it was a trial with a strange result. But yes, they decided that Randall Flint wasn't the person, but there was some evidence. There was some evidence. But as we know, the result was that, yes, Randall Flint wasn't guilty, but there was a case. There wasn't a case of a breach of racial. What is clear that this case contributed to the contributed to making the image of Russia even darker than it was before. Because people read it, and these are I'll just one point that there was a letter to the forwards, and a woman wrote every time about her husband, every time he finishes reading something in the newspaper about the bloodthirsty trial, he gets so upset, so nervous, that he sometimes shows signs of madness. And even after the end of the trial, three English theaters, at that time I believe there were 12 English theaters, not far from this place, three English theaters, they showed on the same day, you could choose to go to a play named Mendel Babies in three separate English theaters in New York and Princeton. So, this also contributed to the position of the forwards during the First World War. And recently my article came out about this position of the forwards during the First World War. It was extremely anti-Russian and openly pro-Jew. Because, again, this was a clash of love and hatred, love to the culture and hatred to the system. And then 1917, when suddenly Russia became this beautiful place of democracy, for a very short period of time, it came together. The love to culture and the love to the country. Suddenly the country was also, and it was the brightest period, at least in terms of the attitude to Russia, in the history of the newspaper, but for a very short period. Thank you.
Gennady, you may very quickly, so the trope that you talk about, which is, you know, to love Tolstoy, claim Tolstoy as your culture, but reject the entire population, and so, in a real resentment and hatred toward it, this is not just about 1913, right? It's a larger thing. Did you want to talk about that a little bit?
If I have. You mean this combination of loving the culture and hating?
Well, it's very selective, you know, and a lot of people who are obsessed with Russian culture, but actually do not like Russia.
Can I piggyback on that question? If you could distinguish between the Russian people and the Russian state, in other words, what was the object of hatred?
Did they distinguish?
I find this topic very interesting. And I was trying to find anything, not from my analysis, whether or contemporary analysis, but something written at that time, how they could explain this schizophrenic attitude to Russia and Russian. And I came across some interesting articles written in the beginning of the century, and they explained the following way, that to them, the Russian culture was detached from Russia, essentially. Because the bulk of Jews didn't live in Russia. They lived elsewhere. Vilna wasn't Russia. Russia proper. Or they lived in contemporary Ukraine or contemporary Belarus or Lithuania or something else. And to them, Russia existed separate from the nation. And they compared this with the Jewish attitude to Polish. To become, they were, if a person, a Jewish person, became involved in Polish culture, in Polish language, they wrote that he would end up being a Pole. Because the pressure was whatever, that they were in the environment. Russia was Deutsche. A car visited Russia proper for the first time in 1957. He left Russia in 1882, never being in Russia proper. And for the first time he came to Russia, and it was common in his circle. The Russian language was something detached from the place, but not completely detached from the population. They idolized, you know, there's interesting, Abe Kahn, when he came to Vilna after the Polish Polish army captured the city, and there was the, what they called the pogrom beginning, generically, but in any case, there was this violence here. And he compared in his articles a Russian pogrom and a Polish pogrom. And he came to the conclusion that they were different. A Russian, when they start a pogrom, they're drunk, they're angry, whatever, they come, but then it's all. and the government is what we're reading in his editorial. The later hundreds of cases, they come and say, sorry. It was something again. But the Poles is different. And the newspaper was consistently on the Polish. Consistently Polish. Well, they wrote openly they didn't want the Polish state. But the Germans or the Russians during the First World War. But because the Poles, it's well organized. It's a day after a day, it's systematic, it's a program after a program.
That's something we don't usually hear.
So this attitude was like the newspaper would publish on a regular basis translations from Russian. Leo Tolstoy was an idol. When Mayakovsky was a communist, when Maxim Gorky came in 1907, I believe, Abe Kahn volunteered to be his interpreter. They translated, they said, you know, it was a complete, but interestingly detached from, actually it developed afterwards, till the end of the 1920s and 1930s, that they have also the schizophrenic attitude to the Soviet Union. We hate the Comintern. We hate the communists. But we love the government. How did they manage to have it in their head? It's difficult to understand, but this was their life. Abe Kahn came to Moscow, didn't want to see anyone associated with the Communist Party directly or whatever, but he was always with the governmental structures. And this was also, they organized and contributed a lot to the fundraising, but to the government, was a socialist government. And somehow only mainly after 1931, after this Menshevik trial in Moscow, they gave up. Not all of them, but the general line is that they gave up, okay, now we can put together. But for a very long time, it was this the way.
But I don't find this separation of attitudes in regard to culture and politics at all unusual. I mean, the anecdotes about German Jews who left in the 30s, you know, are legion, they're going with their collected works of Goethe and Schiller, yes. Right, the exile, or Horkheimer and Adorno writing in German in the 1940s, you know, determined to preserve, you know, the language of the other Germany. So I think one would find this in many instances. You know, what's really interesting, though, is the different attitudes toward Poland and Russia, I think.
And when you, I'm just trying to think, would I be able to say the same thing about Jewish attitude towards Polish culture, and I can think of a few examples, but not as many.
More recently,
absolutely.
More recently, not at this time.
But I think of someone like Singer, right, who denied he spoke Polish, even though he did.
He learned it when he was 16, and then he found a textbook. I was 16 years in Poland.
That's not a very believable story.
Except in the case of German Jews, you have a much greater identification with the real Germany,
yeah,
and with the German state that had been hijacked,
right,
right? Whereas you don't see that in the Russian case. And I think that's a significant difference. Yeah. Right.
Right.
I had a question. If pogroms in Russia were disorganized, take it out of faith, how does that affect, or would it affect, the belief that government, or you know, the government of some sort, the central government, is behind all these pogroms? So you could, then maybe what they would say is then the government itself is unorganized. Of course they can't produce an organized.
Socialist watchdogs. But at that time, the slogan of socialists at that time, pre-boomed arrival of socialists, was, were Jews socialists rather than Jewish socialists. It was very important for them. And somehow they wanted this newspaper, the main socialist newspaper, to keep in balance between being socialists and I think we don't have time. There were quite a few cases when Abe Kahn was accused of being too much on the Jewish side. And this was one of the cases of Frank's case, that was that he was too much obsessed with the Jewishness of this person. Because he went to him. He spent some time with him. He interviewed him. And very open in the newspaper itself at that time. It was somehow not so central as the Beilis was the later. And when you read memoirs by Abe Kahn in just 5 volumes. He didn't have time to write other books. So in the volume that is about this case, it is just the first, I remember it is the opening phrase of the chapter about his process, and then pages about the problem. This became central. For him it was important. And you're right. It was, on the one hand, it was a newspaper whose constituency was, of course, aimed and looked across the ocean, the Arctic, that they would call. At the same time, Acorn wanted to emphasize the American nature. Everything that happened next door was more important, of course, than in Eastern Europe. And I want to talk to her, another interesting, this idea of peasants as good or whatever. In 1926, 7, or whatever, Olga, the same Olga, wrote a novel that was called Havrila and Yoel. The first vegetarian novel there, I guess, from what I know, in English. And this Havrila and Yoel, they for the first time, they meet, so to say, during the book. Havrila came from the village, being obsessed with a Jewish woman, Jewish girl. And the first girl that he found was the girlfriend of this Yoel, and he raped her. And Yoel wasn't able to protect. And this novel ends up when they meet once again, all being members of the Bolshevik Party. And becoming a sort of, you know, it levels that the Jewish guy became strong now and able to fight. And Havrila became able to be a normal person, not a wild person from the present. But again, it shows the same idea. They were primitive, but nice.
What year was the novel?
It was 1927. It was translated later and published in Russian under the title Bregi. Anyways.
Let me ask you a question you probably can't answer, and I don't know if anyone here does, but was anybody in any of the Russian diplomatic posts in the United States reading the forwards and reporting on it? And did anybody in St. Petersburg care?
I know the public library has in its collection a pamphlet of a digest of the forwards published during the Nazi period in Germany. They followed the forwards, and of course they followed the article that they could present as international Jewish conspiracy. And for the forwards I don't believe so. It was read in Europe. It was read in Europe. It could be.
If it was read in Europe, then the Paris Opera probably read it.
Maybe.
I found I worked in the archives of the Ministry of Finance, and they had a branch through the Foreign Ministry which would collect information from foreign countries. Mm-hmm. Disseminated according to the relative ministries, sub-ministries, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. They didn't care at all about the Russian immigration. Mm-hmm. All of the material was about the foreign press, the authentic, the American, mm-hmm. but nothing in the case. No interest.
I
know. No interest. Ziva, did you
want
to?
No,
we passed. Okay. Well, good. Should we move along? We have Nadia. Mm-hmm.
I got interested in this when once Adrian came back from a meeting with the ADL, and he said, do you realize this is the 100th anniversary of the Beilis case? And I thought, no, I did not realize. And so immediately I tried to rustle up a panel for the ASN with Gennady, and we'll do it again with Bob, the Bob and Tony show at Albany. But basically I started thinking, what does it mean that this is the 100th anniversary of the Beilis case? And it had a special resonance for me because when I was in London years ago, dreadfully sick in a house. The only thing to read was the Stilagrafichesky at Chot. The famous case, off the volumes.
What kind of house was it?
I don't want to know. I'm out of that house now.
A safe house.
Exactly, this is the point, that they were looking for a clearing who would be an expert. single Orthodox cleric could be found. And he said, aha, this goes to show that Orthodox Christianity is, in fact, more enlightened, more progressive, better than Roman Catholicism, because, in fact, the only expert religious witness that could be found was a Polish Catholic. And so I started thinking, and I thought, is this in fact the case? Is there no native East Slavic Orthodox tradition for blood accusation? And really there are only, and of course we know that part of the reason for this absence is that there were no Jews in the Russian Empire until the partition of Poland in the end of the 18th century. So with a physical absence of Jews, realistically, you can't blame the Jewish family next door for ritual murder when it isn't there to blame. On the other hand, because in, of course, in the Polish Lithuanian Commonwealth, there were plenty of Belarusian Orthodox people and Ukrainian Orthodox people, if one looks there, one does see things which then trickle into the Russian Orthodox Church. And what I wanted to look at here was one particular martyr cult which existed in the end of the 17th century, but then basically died out until the second half of the 19th century. And so the question here is, why, when blood accusation appears, it actually really does appear in Orthodox Christianity in the end of the 17th century, why does it have no apparent resonance, and why does it kick in again at the end of the 19th century, and does this affect the Beilis case? The first two instances, actually I'm going to mention one that does not appear in the paper that you saw. There was actually a theologian, archimandrite Yanni Kotsonis, who in Polish, first in Polish, in Chernigov, and then in Russian, in Kiev, published a book called The Righteous Messiah, in which he describes various evil deeds perpetrated by Jews, including ritual murder, and adduced in fact four reasons for why this might be the case. But in any case, the interesting thing for us, though, is that this appears to have had no wide resonance. The book was never reprinted. It didn't prompt any additional polemical literature, and in fact, it affected old believers, right, more than it did Jews, because old believers, because they really did exist and were around the corner, could be pointed to for performing dark rituals involving blood, and Jews could not. What's that?
No, it's probably all about sex for us.
But the martyr that I wanted to talk about was Saint Gabriel of Bialystok, an Orthodox Christian boy killed at the age of... I know, exactly. Well, wait for it. Killed at the age of six in 1690. But what I want to stress is that Gabriel of Bialystok was not Saint George on the Dragon or Saint Patrick of Ireland. He was never formally canonized. This is very, very important. The first liturgical reference to him dates only in 1908, which is more than 200 years after his demise, but only 3 years away from the Beilis case. And this is more for the people who work on religion and the people who work on everything else. And that is that it is extremely important to see when liturgical commemoration begins. Because until that, something stays completely local, no wider resonance at all. It's only when someone makes it into the service books that they can be said to exist from a technical point of view. So in the paper, I'm not going to do this all here. I actually trace the growth of the cult. First, a brief mention in a church history in 1815, but it's referred to only as a body and an object of local interest by 1862. Another small mention in a larger book refers to the body as relics, but by the middle of the 19th century, for all intents and purposes, Gabriel of Bialystok exists. It's acknowledged that he's a local cult somewhere in Pechayev, but not anywhere else in the Russian Empire. So we're not talking about the kind of empire-wide canonization that are given to people like Bishop Dmitry of Rostov, for example, or Bishop Mitrofan of Voronezh. But by the end of the 19th century, veneration of Gabriel speeds up, that it's recounted a Tropad and a Kandak composed to him. There are a few visual depictions, but it is only really in the last decade of the 19th century that the movement gains momentum, and in 1893, Archbishop Domak Babinski Sokolov orders that all the churches in his diocese have icons with a depiction of the martyr. In 1897, there's a silver case that houses Gamaliel's relics open so that you can see the wounds in his hands. There is a procession. But for the Beilis case, I think the most important thing is an interview that happens with Archbishop Antoni Kropovitsky in 1905 in a small newspaper in Zhytomyr, in which he's asked, because I should say that he has a reputation for being a progressive. When the Kishinev pogrom happens in 1903, he publishes a very long and impassioned sermon about how Jews are the beloved people of Christ. They are the only people who know for sure that they will be saved at the end of days. They are God's chosen. By killing Jews, you Christians have destroyed, you know, the chosen nation. So the point is, Jews thought that he was Jew-friendly. I stress this, which is why they wanted to interview him about the topic of ritual murder. So you can imagine their disappointment. The disappointment of this newspaper when Kropovitsky says, well, as a matter of fact, if you read the Book of Kings and look at what happens to Saul, it's possible that some variant of ritual murder might exist. But he said, frankly, if it exists, it doesn't really matter, because what's the murder of one Christian or two? What's really important is the sort of more dangerous, insidious political evil that Jews are perpetrating upon the Russian nation. So ritual murder is the least of our problems. We have other things to worry about. But Gamaliel only gets his service. He finally gets his service in 1908. And for you liturgical nerds out there, I have to say this is not one of the great Orthodox services of all time. It's not Apostle Matins, Dr. Sasser. But what is interesting, though, is the deliberate attempt made at every point in the service to parallel liturgical texts from Holy Week, and specifically Passion references for Great and Holy Thursday and Great and Holy Friday. So for example, I'll give you just two very, very small selections, one from the liturgical text for Pascha, and then one for the liturgical text to Gamaliel. So on Great and Holy Thursday, the service reads, the assembly of the Jews gathered, I could do it in Slavonic for us. The assembly of the Jews gathers together to deliver to Pilate, the maker and creator of all, what lawlessness, what faithlessness. The service to Gabriel, sung to the same tune, says, the assembly of the Jews gathers together from Brest to Bialystok to deliver, to deliver to torment the immaculate infant. What lawlessness, what faithlessness. On Great and Holy Friday, a strange horror it was to see the maker of heaven and the earth suspended on the cross. The sun was darkened and the day was changed to night, to Gabriel. A strange horror it was for parents to see their infant's body mutilated in the field among hounds lying like faithful guards. The sun was darkened and the day was changed to night. So mostly by drawing on the existing rich imagery of Passion Week, the service to Gabriel emphasizes the theme of nefarious Jews plotting against an innocent Christian. But there are other liturgical elements as well. Gabriel is compared to the Maccabee martyrs commemorated by the Jews on Hanukkah and the Orthodox at the beginning of the Dermishan fast. But, I quote, he was made like unto them by the murderous action of their unworthy kin. The service also evokes Herod and the slaughter of the innocents. So again, an adult plotting the slaughter of small children. Now, this service to Gamaliel, it's important that it exists, but there's no indication that it was ever served outside of Pachayev, ever served outside the area where the relics were. It never made it into the official service books, the big bound service books that everybody gets. It was only in off-print, and it's not clear, because this was before they printed the tirage on the back of the page, it's not clear how widely spread this was. But it's enough to say that that the renewed attention paid to martyr Gabriel at the end of the 19th and the beginning of the 20th centuries both responded to and may have fostered a climate conducive to Orthodox Christians being prepared to admit the possibility of the ritual murder of Orthodox Christians by their Jewish neighbors. I should point out that devotees, it became extremely dangerous in the Soviet Union to be a devotee of Gabriel after 1917. Patriarch Jan Vostorgov, the priest of St. Basil's Cathedral in Moscow, was arrested for serving molyvens to Gabriel in front of his reliquary. The presiding judge at another trial connected the veneration of Gabriel, said that anyone who does this is hateful and contra-revolutionary. But most interesting for our purposes is that the atheist publishing house printed a denunciation of ritual accusation explicitly linking Gabriel with the Beilis affair. It was called The Holy Youth of Gabriel, a Medieval Beilisia. So I was transposing it back. We can, if discussion permits, if you're interested, we can talk about what happened to the veneration of Gabriel after fact, what the status of the veneration of Gabriel is now, but suffice it to say that originally the cult of Gabriel of Bialystok arose in the context of Orthodox Uniate Jewish tensions in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. It remained a strictly local phenomenon in Belarus and Western Ukraine until the end of the 19th century, but the modernization in the Russian Empire, sparked by the great reforms of Alexander II and the emphasis on Russian nationalism by Alexander III and Nicholas II, led to a flowering of the cult of Gabriel, and the 1917 revolution led to a condemnation of blood accusation and to an explicit negative linkage of Gabriel with the case.
Only you can write these things.
I think it's
remarkable actually that they can't find one cleric, right, to testify. I do find it remarkable. And I wonder if it's because they're so poorly educated or if it's because they actually don't want to.
No. By now there are 4 theological academies, there's a wide network of seminaries. They're not. But the point is, this is not a staple of theological instruction. It just isn't widely spread enough. And on the other hand, what you're suggesting is interesting because obviously someone like Antoni Kotovitsky knew something about this and in theory could have, but chose not to.
Why?
Well, you know, maybe this. Okay, so there is no tradition, Eastern Orthodox, you know, ritual or Western Christianity. And yet there's no problem having people believe that Jews at the time of the Beilis Trial believe in ritual murder. So I've always been curious about this. So there's anti-Semitism in the Russian Empire, you must be without Jews being there. All of a sudden 500,000 Jews show up in the late 18th century. Those are the Jews who bring with them the tradition of ritual murder. And somehow that will then become will permeate the rest of Russian.
I don't understand why.
In other words, it's the Jews from where the Jews are living in the Pale of Settlement. Those are the Gentiles who have the tradition.
It's a function of contact.
Yes, the contact, it's, you know, the Uniates, Catholicism, that has the tradition. And yet, in a century, you'll find most people, most who knows, the idea that ritual murder is a possibility or reality is believed by many, many Orthodox believers. And so I'm always interested in how you get that transmission of this idea to society in general. And I also just another comment about the you also talk about the unworthy kin being guilty. That's sort of like in the Beilis trial. It's not all Jews in SLE, it's the fanatics, it's Abkhazs, the Volgians in particular. I remember reading a quote from some Jew from Odessa. He said, look, I can tell you, Odessa Jews were progressive. we don't engage in this kind of theory. I can't tell you for sure whether or not four religions up there in the Northwest, but they don't, because they're fanatics. So, who knows? But they're unworthy.
I'm actually not convinced. I mean, I haven't studied this specially, but I'm not convinced that among Orthodox Christians in Russia proper, as opposed to Ukraine and Belarus, in the middle of the 19th century, that they widely believe this. I mean, I haven't seen it. It doesn't appear in print. It doesn't appear in religious journals. It doesn't appear in the popular religious press. So, I mean, I haven't seen the, I mean, I was looking for the paper trail. I was looking for evidence of this. I haven't seen evidence of this.
Sermons.
Nicholas II,
this is certainly possible. So that,
Nicholas II is the end of the 19th century.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's not a century. Not
you
just like
in the middle of the 19th century when the when Daniel Colson, who actually is, he could be considered an Orthodox expert on the question of Jewish murder, of Jewish origin, who converted. He's requested by the Tsarist Commission to investigate this whole tradition. It's interesting that there's nobody left at the theological faculty who engages in some kind of explanation of the state murder.
Well, the interesting thing is that they're not interested in it. I mean, it's just that they're not interested in it as a religious problem. I mean, and actually,
but still as a state witness, as an expert.
Right.
Well, the argument he makes is actually not a theological argument. The argument he makes in the interview is actually a political argument about political generation, about political calendar. I think that's interesting, because, they want to know about ritual murders, and he makes an argument about apology as a whole.
Well, the thing is, when do blood accusation cases begin? There's one in 1823, there's the good one in Sarata between 1852. So in that sense, you could make the case that people do already, clearly people are willing to believe it. And Sarata is not in the Pale of Solomon. So by the mid-19th century, yes. I mean, the very fact that such an accusation can be brought suggests that people are willing to believe it.
Also because of this. The use beyond the realm of religion.
Right.
I'm just curious what we'll find if we'll look east and look at the animists. Were there any beliefs among the Orthodox clerics into a possibility of ritual murder among the pagans?
Yeah, there were Erdwards who were accused in the 1870s and 80s.
And the
thing was
the
top
piece.
The cannibalism.
I actually think that the primary reason that people are willing to believe it is that, as in Catholicism, in Spain and in Germany, there are actually plenty of cases of people pretending to take communion, but saving little bits of it, bringing it home and using it for magical purposes.
That's post-desecration.
Yes, right. But the point is, but this really happens. And so since people are willing to believe about themselves that they take little bits of the Eucharist and use it for nefarious purposes, although usually for love potions.
Yeah.
Right. But still, if you're willing to believe it about your fellow co-religionist, it's only one extra step to say, oh, well, it's I can see that would be the progression, but I think it would happen, you see what I mean, from within and from the Eucharist, as opposed to from the outside.
I mean, it seems to me that it's sort of a common thread between what you're deciding about people believing about people within their own community, and then also accusations about these fanatic Jews, and then also I think you're right that there is this tradition of Russians being concerned about animists performing ritual murder, but it's about fanaticism, mm-hmm. Right? That's what's unacceptable, not necessarily Judaism or animism, and obviously not Orthodoxy, but anything,
fanatic.
I mean, that's
just,
you see
fanatic. Mm-hmm.
This is a term that's constantly being
referred to. Ask you about a different context. One small point. Did Alexander I deny the validity of ritual murder accusations in 1817? I get this from working out. And he just mentions it in a little more than in passing, but that this was seen as a kind of
by Nicholas as a kind of application of Western ideas of jurisprudence that isn't entirely relevant to the Russian case, which made me think
by
that Nicholas, by Nicholas II, looking back, looking back on Alexander the First. And that brought to mind that it's interesting that the revival is from the 1690s, sort of, well, not quite pre-Petrine, but pretty close. Is this at all part of this kind of, or a kind of imagined revival of Muscovy? I mean, why go back if this is something that's taken from this conflicted borderland or from the movement in of the Jews, with the partition movement in, the borders moving out. It just seems sort of curious that they go back that far, and is there some kind of in the imagination of regime officials in the early 20th century that this is something that was maybe legitimate before this sort of westernization of the Petrine administration, and now is being, is worth reviving? A bad idea that why don't we double down on, or I don't know.
It's an interesting idea. It's possible. I mean, that I'm looking at it here from the point of view of the clerical hierarchy and less about the state, but the state obviously. I think Alexander III and Nicholas II clearly don't have a problem with it. So it is very possible. It's an interesting idea.
One other quick question. Could you, we don't have to do this right now, but could you talk a little more about Kropyvnytsky and progressivism as a progressive? Because I think what it means to be a progressive, as you used the word, clergy in the late 19th, early 20th century strikes me, it's sort of curious to me that they would think that he was a fan of the Jews, or, because when he comes through Ufa briefly, I mean, he certainly stirs things up and energizes people, but it's in the sense of, we've got to fight off the Muslims. You know what I mean? It's not at all, it didn't surprise me at all that he would have this sort of view, and in fact, it surprised me that you say that he comes out to defend the Jews after the problem.
Well, I think that he's certainly not considered a progressive, broadly speaking, and he's not progressive, broadly speaking, but...
I didn't think you meant that. That's
right. But his, it's really more that Jews thought that he was a philo-Semite. That defense of Jews after the Kishinev pogrom was so amazing, so eloquent, and so long, and so articulate that actually the Jewish community in Odessa had it reprinted separately to distribute among the population, to educate them, and see, this is what one of their most revered archbishops says, listen to him. So they were, so it was the Jewish community of Odessa, that was behind publicizing this sermon.
Yeah, but in 1881, 1882, sermons in Orthodox churches that have been studied, preach almost entirely against the threat to restraint. It's a threat to order. Right?
Yeah.
It's the last thing that
people
want. So this is not something new or really particularly unusual.
No, but what was unusual was that this wasn't about the threat to order as such. That actually wasn't mentioned. It was more that this is a desecration of the Paschal feast.
Mm.
That, in other words, that this is a religious
abomination.
That's what's interesting about it. That, on the day when Christ is crucified, you are crucifying his people. That kind of thing.
Mm.
It's extremely unusual.
Yeah.
Right?
Thanks.
Yeah. Well, I think what's really interesting about this presentation is the way I think really brings to the forefront a way of thinking about the distinction between a anti-Jewish is grounded in the evil folk legend, right, and modern anti-Semitism. And now, in no sense trying to deny that there are obvious linkages between the two, I think analytically at least, and this, I think even historically and functionally, they are different things. And Roman Catholic experts they're calling on, that's actually not representative at the time of certainly not the Polish church, where if you read that, there are some people who will say, maybe we don't quite know for sure that there's no such thing as a ritual mortar, but it's very unlikely. That's the stance of the Jesuits newspaper in Poland. And it's becoming embarrassing. 1890s, 1900s, 1910s. So it's becoming really embarrassing for a Catholic to admit they believe in the blood libel if they're sort of an educated, you know, sophisticated Catholic.
No, but actually that's true because Poland doesn't have a state.
Right.
So, I mean, so that in fact, this is actually an argument for saying that it's specifically connected to the modern state, the modern techniques of dissemination that it's executed.
Well, in Galicia they almost do. And it actually is in Galicia where that Jesuit periodical comes from. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that that's it, because I think the they have a national movement which is very statist, and so a lot of the language and ideology is going to be the same. It's exactly what you said, that it's more, you know, why are we still talking about blood libels? That's something peasants believe in. We should be talking about the threat of the international Jewish conspiracy, right? The manifestation of Jewishness in capitalism and socialism. Not blood libels, that's probably a superstition, probably. Oh, we can't know for sure, but probably. Right. That's the one.
Yeah.
But there is Sikorsky.
And the Japan and Sundomiers is never.
Not
still a focus.
And again, the line is,
that was 1750.
Yeah, those are simple people, we'll let them have their beliefs. No. You know, the official line is to make that if you're an educated Catholic, but
they
are kind of tolerated among the masses. Yeah.
I agree with this, but I agree also that it's actually divided sometimes in terms of condemnability. It's also interesting how persistent such beliefs are. I heard recently a story in Lithuania how local students were invited to the local Jewish community. It was Passover and Matzah was on the table here, and only two of them. Because just in case. And also, for example, this perennial fear that gypsies will take children. Mm-hmm. I grew up with this, and really, I remember how people would hide their children. This is also not from the church, but just in case to hide children. Well, my question is, are there any documents that reflect discussions in the church? Say, a meeting, a correspondence, or whatever, or maybe a decision somewhere in the top echelons of the church, no, we don't participate in this, and this has been well stored.
I think you're right. I think it has to be there, but I haven't found it yet. But it's not to say that it's not there. It seems very unlikely. It sounds very unlikely that it wouldn't have happened, because I mean, the synod and bishops met together to discuss whether or not to allow electricity in churches. I mean, they thought of everything, and this was a big deal. So it's hard to imagine.
The Vatican was not issued similar instructions in a very formal way, like about 6 or 8 times over the last 700 years.
That's
much good.
As a matter of fact, Valery Dimshitz in St. Petersburg is doing really interesting studies with interviewing people who live in former shtetls, asking them about their beliefs about blood and lots and everything else.
Who is this?
Valery
Dimshitz.
Historically, some of the ritual murder.
that in itself is an interesting question, because when you think about it logically, of course you would want to ask a convert, someone with insider knowledge, who knew presumably both, and could shed light on both.
Right.
So why you would actually want to look within the Orthodox, so maybe sort of maybe we're fine, maybe finally we have enough of our own experts. That's actually very
interesting. No, but I think, can I handle this briefly? I think it's because you have a jury of, you know, relatively uneducated people, and for an Orthodox priest or cleric would be an authority figure for them that they would accept. So
oh,
I think that
point.
It's also part of the dynamic of the jury.
That's true. I mean, in other words, we have these Ukrainian peasants. They're not going to listen to a converted Jew, but they might listen to an Orthodox priest. Is that the idea? That's
what the question was.
Yeah.
Quick question. This is the period of developed Orthodox press. Was there any response to this case? Missionary journals, or
what? It's really amazing, because you would think, I mean, that they just didn't want to touch it, which is, and you're right, that itself. I mean, that in the local they did cover this and so on, but it was more along the lines of reporting the trial. But actually, Kharkovitsky set the stage, because once an important bishop who was in Volyn as well as Ufa, as soon as he says that this can be, that it's possible that this might exist, then that in fact is the signal for saying, well, this is okay and it's possible. But they don't really take the ball and run with it. That is, but thank you for it.
Well, good. We should move along. Paul Weinberg.
Okay. Some of the stuff I was going to talk about has been brought up in various ways. And before, so were those computers connected to the screen up there? If I had to flash it, yeah. And then, if I had nothing to talk about, which is interesting. And, okay, that was it. So, so I guess the Beilis case will raise up issues that I guess we can talk about of official anti-Semitism, state-sponsored anti-Semitism versus, sort of, I guess, for a better phrase, popular anti-Semitism, what is the average person believe, and look at the trial and getting back to the trial transcript that you read when you were sick. We're not talking, I mean, we're talking, you know, about
yes.
This double column. The Russian judicial system was interesting because anything that you wanted to enter into evidence had to be read into the transcript. So if you read the transcript, you can read all of the fabricated testimony, all the changes of testimony, the lies, the made-up evidence, it's all there. So you don't need to look behind the scenes because they entered it all in. So it always baffles the imagination to think you have 12 people sitting on a jury. Okay, that's good enough. Thank you. How'd you know those were the files? It's the NYU. Well, if you can read, then you can decode all that.
Yeah.
You can get that. No, anyway. So, how do you have, even if the peasants or peasant stop, people can listen and they can make up their own minds. And yet the government was convinced it could depend on the jury's belief that Jews engage in ritual murder. And it's not necessarily an issue of education, as far as I'm concerned, or ignorance of being part of the, you know, United Network. It's right, because you have very educated, very sophisticated people actually believing in ritual murder. And they were able to use this service, religious and medieval anti-Semitism, to help support their arguments for what we would refer to as sort of
one local official, under pressure from the local black hundreds, decides that let's go for the Jews, let's try to show that this was a ritual murder case. Now, some people argue that he took seriously the black hundred threats, and if you do not pursue this murder as a ritual murder, like libel, you will start to grow. Since I'm not one of those people that believes that Kibbutz could be organized in that kind of manner, it's much more spontaneous, more combustible. It's hard to say. No doubt the man, the local official, may have believed in the ritual murder, but he was able to get the Minister of Justice, who decided to pursue it and get the okay. So I'm not sure why the Minister of Justice decides to engage in this conspiracy. It may be that, and this is just sort of an educated guess, that the government, the autocracy is under a lot of pressure from foreign governments, the Jewish lobby in the United States, elsewhere. There are talks of certain kinds of trade embargoes or on the empire. Right around this time, there's discussion in the Duma about getting rid of the Pale of Settlement. And it may be that some of the officials believe that if we can demonstrate to the world in a court of law, and the Russian judicial system was fairly well respected in the West at this time, if we can have a trial by peers to show that Jews engage, or at least this one Jew engaged in this behavior, in this kind of behavior, then couldn't we then say, see, we're justified in being suspicious of Jews. Maybe we are justified in keeping Jews separate from the rest of society. I don't know. But they may have thought it would work to their benefit and help some have a public image of the autocracy to show that Jews, or some Jews, engage in this kind of behavior. So, what are they? So, I think Gennady mentions it in his paper. They know as when the trial is occurring, they realize the government is saying very little about Beilis himself as being a perpetrator, right? They're spending most of the time trying to demonstrate the veracity of the ritual murder. And what they do try to show is that Beilis is one of those fanatics, because his father and the owner of the brick factory, or the founder of the brick factory, the murder supposedly took place, were very observant Jews. Moreover, the year before, a merchant by the name of Schneerson showed up at the brick factory. So there's that connection, okay, between Beilis and Lubavitch's Schneerson. And, you know, Beilis knows nothing about this, you know, the Lubavitch. If he's religious, why is he working on a Saturday? Right? I mean, think about it.
Yes.
It's ingenious. Okay, that's ingenious. And then, if Jews throughout the world engage in this kind of behavior every year at Passover and Easter, why don't we have tens or hundreds of thousands of reported missing children? Right? All I can recall is one mention in the newspaper article, people trying to show the falsehood. He mentions it. Most people don't even mention the Albans. You'd think it'd be fewer Christian children running around. It's the truth, but logic somehow flies out the window in this case. Of course, now I digress. I can't remember where I was. Schneerson, right. Apparently, he sent police to Schneerson's house and knocked on the door. They were trying to get some information. And according to the newspaper account, the woman answered the door, presumably the Rebbe's wife, and they said, "We'd like to speak to Mr. Schneerson," or whatever. And she said, "He's way too busy to talk to you. true, not true, anyway. But the issue is, why do they think they can believe in this So how do they go about trying to demonstrate that this is a real phenomenon? And they, it's a medieval superstition, but they have to cast it in a way that would pass muster in the modern age, right? They don't want to just, they want to demonstrate that modern science can defend or support these accusations. I mean, that's the way they have to do it. I mean, remember, by 1900 in Russia, there was a very vibrant civil society. There were newspapers, journals, opinions on all sides being expressed. And so they need to find, I hadn't really thought of this before, something more than just a theological explanation. They can't, right, they find this Roman Catholic priest who's sketchy character at best. Realism that he's talking about, but nonetheless is a self-pronounced expert on the Talmud from the 1890s. But they also look for experts. Now, I think in the paper I could quote this one right-wing newspaper saying that, you know, what the defense doesn't want you to believe is that in the state of of airplanes and trams that we can have ritual murder as well. The two are mutually exclusive. So let's try to put into some perspective, and I may realize I'm going to be somebody, hope I'm not. If over a majority of Americans believe in angels, then why not believe 100 years ago a group of uneducated Ukrainians would also believe that Jews believe in engaging this kind of behavior? There's no way you can sort of scientifically prove it one way or the other, but you can try to make a case for it. In this case, it's not an issue of faith, so they bring in experts, right? Yanni mentioned Sikorsky. Sikorsky is this retired psychiatrist, eminent psychiatrist at the university, he's retired, and he is a firm believer in the ritual murder. And he says, you know, when he looked at the autopsy report, and again when he testified 2.5 years later, he said the autopsy clearly shows not only was the boy killed in a deliberate manner to drain the body of all its blood, but you can tell that it was done by some sort of revenge or vendetta of, he doesn't use the word Jews, but people of the House of Jacob. Okay, right. I never use the word ritual murder, even in the indictment. Says it has. It looks as if the murder was conducted in a way to drain the body of blood. So they don't. And they don't necessarily mention Jews. In the transcript and when they talk about it, it's clearly that they're talking about.
You know, how many wounds did you get?
There were about 48.
How did that not?
Intentional. Well, because some of the wounds were done after he was dead. So. Apparently, he's not all the blood drained out. He still had some blood left, but you're right. He was viciously murdered and stabbed, as you can see. But people, you know, people trying. So they have Sikorsky trying to demonstrate that this, as a psychiatrist, this new social science that I'm an expert in, can demonstrate that this. We also have the value of the sanctity of the word, of the written word, whether it's the Bible or. Now we're going to show that Hebrew texts, Jewish texts, demonstrate this. Of course, not everybody is privy to what's said in the Hebrew scriptures or in the Talmud or in Kabbalistic literature because it's written in a language most of us don't read. I know, I grew up in an Orthodox synagogue for family reasons, and I never really knew Hebrew, so while I could go through the motions for 4 hours on a Saturday morning, I didn't really know what was going on. So if you're a stranger to any of this, Hebrew synagogue services are totally opaque. They make no sense. Right? Because they don't even know you
should be. Not even if you do know what's going on.
Yeah. Just remember, they didn't allow you to cheat by having some English translation on your website. Right? That's just bad. No vowels, just Hebrew. So clearly, you know, they need to find experts that can decode this. And you're right, it's interesting they often use converted Jews, and they do that in the case of the Beilis trial. They rely on this Catholic priest who pretends he knows what he's talking about. And but not only that, there are also very well-known intellectuals, public intellectuals, whatever you call them, who are also sincerely believers in ritual murder, and they need to decode the wounds. So in that first picture, one of the police investigators asked someone, and I'm not really sure who this person was, to sort of go through the material, the evidence that they collected after a few months to see if they could figure out what's going on. This man goes through the evidence and he looks at these wounds on the right forehead, connects them, and says, you know, they look like constellations. Okay? He then names the constellations, Ram, Taurus, Northern Corona, whatever. But he gives no explanation of what any of this meant. And I even wrote to the Russian Astrological Society just to see what they have to say. I never heard back. And I also realized if it's some sort of astrological reading, then the dates, because of the different calendars, would have to be taken into account. Anyway, I was just curious. So anyway, but that's what you have here, right? Belief that there's some sort of occult or mystical astrological significance to the wounds. If you want to click the next one. Okay, so here's the constellations at the bottom, Russian names of the constellations. Some are in the body, some are in the torso, the head, and so on. Okay? Yeah, I don't know what it means. I suppose I take it to an astrologer and see what they can make of it, but I didn't go that far. Anyway. Next one. Okay, so there are these intellectuals. This is a well-known writer, philosopher, Vasily Rozanov, who in his writings he fixates on blood and Jews and the role of blood in Judaism and so on and so forth. Based on an article he read by someone else, guy who's it's not clear what the man's name is, he says, this man has broken the code, right? Right, Jews aren't going to be stupid enough to write about ritual murder in the text. So because all you have to do is learn some Hebrew, Aramaic, and the Jew is up there, you know. So it's got to be even more secret. And only certain Jews will understand this because they are privy to it. If you connect the wounds, okay, so what happened was apparently, imagine I'm laying prostrate and I get wounded in the head. When they took the body and put him in the cave where they found him, his head went down. Okay, so that's what this looks like. I don't know about you, but obviously if you connect those dots, you get those Hebrew letters.
Which is a Cyrillic letter also.
Yeah. Well, what can I say? My Hebrew is not up to what it used to be. And I wrote more in the paper than I'll say here. But these punctures always correspond to Hebrew letters, and they refer to parts of the Zohar, Russian mystical Kabbalah, about the injunction of Jews or the obligation of Jews needing to obtain blood from Gentiles for ritual purposes. So, cryptography. The FBI program is special. Anyway, these various letters, over the years, having studied anti-Semitism pogroms and this sort of stuff, I have to keep a sense of humor, because it's so nuts as far as I can tell. These letters refer to five phenomena. Man, mouth, head, chest, and arrow. Okay? And so Rozanov's conclusion is Yushinsky, the dead boy, was killed by strikes to the head and chest, just like the calf sacrificed to Jehovah by the Hebrews. Okay? And there's also, if you look at the positioning, they also refer to the injunction Exodus that Jews should obtain the blood of non-Jews at the time of Passover. I suppose that's sort of sacrifice connects to the sacrifice, you know, the blood on the doorposts of, you know, the Passover, you know, or the firstborn. Okay? Another person looks at the wounds and said, you know, if you look at the functions in certain ways, and you end up with two triangles, it's the Star of David. And the Star of David, you know, signifies blood, sacrifice, and worship of the devil. Okay, the point is, we may sort of say, you know, this is sort of musings of a crackpot, but there's more than one crackpot running around saying this. Very educated, highly intelligent, well-read, highly westernized people is thinking about this in this way, and then presenting it to a jury that's mystified by anything Jews do, right? I mean, the Jews speak, I mean, outside of maybe in having day-to-day contact with Jews, Jews are speaking Yiddish. You're not really going to know what they're saying. The Lord knows what happens in a synagogue service, as I said. You know, I'm not sure. Not to mention the issue of modernity in the paper. And I think this is really, it's much more than just sort of modern anti-Semitism. It's a way of, and you talk about the railway system, but it's also how news gets disseminated. The telegraph, right? People in the United States are going to know pretty much the same day, the next morning, what happened in Kiev, right? The day before the trial. So the world has become much more connected and smaller. And I think part of it, and that's part of the reason is that everybody in the world is trying, you know, in the Jewish world, in educated society, certainly in Russia, the Russian Empire, throughout Europe, the United States, everybody knows who mental balance is during the trial. These vulnerable kids, some of the equivalent of, you know, Osama bin Laden, you know, in the diverse number of ideas. But anyway, so his face would be known.
Scholars will justifiably mention that there never was any evil ritual murder accusation against Jews in the Kingdom of Poland. True, that it comes from the West, it comes from the Latin West, and that's all very true, of course, and Protestants like to blame it all on the Catholic Church. So, okay, I mean, I'm not sure that there's any real pride in being able to claim being the last one to own this accusation. I think that there, I thought that as a kind of social cultural historian, I was both Unionists and Orthodox in the Gettysburg Studies, for example. To really look at it closely, what kinds of knowledge are shared, what kinds of practices are shared. Or alternatively, if one piggyback onto some of the interpretations of scholars of the medieval accusation, are there anxieties within Orthodox practice regarding the Eucharist and the elements of the Eucharist and the religious service? The divine liturgy, which might show that even if there isn't a well-formed narrative about Jewish ritual criminality, there's some of the anxieties that lend credibility, plausibility to accusations of co-desecration or ritual that might come to the fore. And finally, note is that there's a strong early modern tradition of Orthodox accusations against Jews in the Ottoman Empire, Greek Orthodox accusations, which were almost always suppressed by the Ottoman government as being something they didn't want to hear about. Really, until the 19th century, when in Damascus, for a variety of reasons, the Russians in 1840, Corfu in 1879, and so I'm wondering how much communication there is across Orthodox communities as well. I'm particularly interested in this case because I've been working for a number of years, decades, on trying to explain this reappearance and kind of explosion of state prosecutions against Jews for on the crime of ritual murder from the 1880s onwards into the early years of the 20th century. So Beilis is really the end point in this series of five or six very sensational trials. They begin in Hungary in the Austrian Empire in 1882-83. And it moves to Prussia, but in this case in the Weinland Prussia, in the town of Xanten, which is in the early 1890s, and back to Austria in the Czech town of Polna, which is Pilsner case, which really is simultaneous to the Dreyfus affair in France, and there's a lot of symbolic communication across countries and across the political systems about the relationship between Gilsner and Dreyfus, and actually between Emil Zola and Tomasz Moszek, who's one of the great defenders of the Jews in the community. And then back to the German Empire in the early 20th century, in Konitz in West Prussia, which is after 1918, so after 1902, really, then we have to wait until the Beilis case for this phenomenon to kind of run its course. One of the things that I noted in Bob's paper. And the more I think about the Beilis case, which is not one that I'm writing directly about more as an epilogue in my own book, is how different it is from the others. The very fact that the state characterized the crime specifically as a ritual murder, and then did this very bizarre thing in the indictment to charge the jury, first of all, with finding Beilis himself guilty of the crime, but secondly, of coming to a determination as to whether the murder of the Chinsky boy in question was an example of ritual murder. states that I'm looking at the end of the 19th and early 20th century would never have never have allowed themselves to articulate such positions or to use this kind of language. So for example, in my four cases, the four main cases, justice ministries, prosecuting attorneys, and trial judges work very hard to contain, actually, and to marginalize explicit appeals to ritual murder discourse. For the most part, such theories of the crime called for an understanding of damage as ritual murder, these theories percolated along the boundaries of various investigations and trial proceedings. The ritual murder accusation functioned as a kind of refrain that was sung by newspaper editors, politicians, lawyers, family members, sometimes attorneys representing the interests of family members, but acting in the role as a chorus, if you will. But the state's top prosecutors and justice officials took great pains to operate according to what I would call the epistemological structures of modern science and forensic procedures. They implicitly, I think, accepted the disciplinary constraints of such things as modern criminal codes, and rules of evidence, the authority of scientific experts. And they would have been mortified to have articulated publicly anything that resembled a belief in the ritual murder accusation. There's one major exception to this rule, and that involved the young magistrate, whose name was Jozsef Bodi, in the Tisza Esztar case in 1882. Hungary followed a procedure similar to France, where the investigation is organized by a judge, an instructional judge, a judge magistrate, and it's handed over to state prosecutors. And Buddy appears genuinely to have believed that the disappearance and death of 14-year-old Esther Shomashi involved in ritual murder, compounded by a larger conspiracy to conceal the crime. And so in the end, 15 Jewish defendants stood trial in the county seat of Nadieszda in June and July of 1883. But this was also the case that inaugurated, I think, the general pattern that would come to dominate the Central European trials. At least for the first decade and a half, as the state's attorney, whose task it was to present the state's case in court, came to believe in the untenable nature of the charges and the unreliability of witnesses for the prosecution, and also in the contaminating effects of the surrounding discourse of Jewish ritual murder. And in his closing remarks, if not earlier, then certainly in his closing remarks, he argued against his own case, urging the three-judge panel hearing the case to find and a similar set of events characterized the next major ritual murder trial, the Xanten case, which was tried in Clay in 1882. And here the state's attorneys, or two in the case, reluctantly allowed the writ of indictment to be handed down against the defendant, but decried the poison political atmosphere surrounding the proceedings and directed the jury, almost from the start, to find the So the state's strategy in the Beilis case, I should say it's not the picture actually gets murkier because in the Czech case, the prosecuting attorney, the state's attorney, is committed to the case from the start, but he characterizes it as a sex crime or simply a murder. But allows the general discussion of Jewish ritual murder to make its way into the trial proceedings through the defendants, through the families, also part of the proceedings. Later became the mayor of Prague. And actually, Hilsner is convicted and sentenced to death. And then the Vienna insists that the ministry in Vienna insists that the case would turn out partly through Mossad's intervention, and then he retried, and it was retried, this time he again and sense the death again eventually, which is hardened during the First World War. So the state's strategy, I think, in this case, if anything, it represents the inverse of the earlier four trials. In those cases, the state, for the most part, attempted to navigate what you might call a rational course, surrounded by loud discussions on Jewish morality, and occasionally tolerating, if not encouraging, such noise. Prosecuting attorneys took a variety of tacks, ranging from, as I suggested, subverting the state's case and arguing for acquittal, to presenting a charge less than murder, to pushing all the way to a conviction and sentencing death. But they never asked the judges or the jury to weigh in on whether or not a, quote, ritual murder had been committed. And yet this is precisely what the Rehabilitation Space is asking. And according to one of the lawyers, whom Bob mentions, who had assisted the prosecution, had the jury found Beilis guilty of murder, but that the government had not proven the ritual aspect of the crime, prosecutors would not have been sentenced. So here one wants to obviously, I think, explain why the state should, in a sense, not have viewed itself in a in line with the general trajectory of the Central European ritual murder trials, but as though it had no, it was totally ignorant of that very recent tradition and what it was actually trying to do. So it suggests, I think, that the interest wasn't really in Beilis. As you mentioned, the interest is in its in Jews and in its policies with regard to Jews, and perhaps also the revolutionary unrest, as Thomas suggests. So, that might, I think, be one of the answers. And finally, with regard to the writings of various Silver Age Russian authors on Judaism and Kabbalah, what strikes me is how insular this process was, and in two senses of the term. First of all, it's a completely internal model that's going on. It amounts really to the musings of dilettantes about the meanings of possibly existing, possibly invented signifiers within a literature that they could barely enter. And second, the discussions of the supposedly anti-Christian and anti-social teachings of the Talmud, of the Zohar, and the post-Zohar Jewish texts, this also comes at the tail end of a very long period of discussion, beginning at the earliest with the publication of August Roland's The Talmud Judah, in 1871, if not to Eisenmenger's Entdeckung des Judentums from the beginning of the 18th century. And I don't get much of a sense of awareness on the part of our writers, awareness of or communication with this tradition of anti-Jewish writing, which is interesting because Roland himself was a professor of scripture, of Hebrew scripture at the Catholic University of Prague at the time, and say a civil servant of a halter. And in 1883, he had written a letter to the court in Nadieszda offering his services as an expert witness who could testify to the existence of Jewish teaching. At the time, he thought he could find it in the Talmud. His offer of service was ignored by the Hungarian court, although it was publicized very largely, very widely in the anti-Semitic press in the Austrian Empire. And this prompted one of Vienna's rabbis, perhaps not the leading one, Josef Samuel Bloch, to challenge Rowling in the press as well. In fact, Rowling at one time offered something like 300 gulden, which is a fairly large sum, to anyone who we'll see what we can do. Apparently, that was indeed a challenge. Rowan didn't sue Bloch right away for this, but when Bloch became aware of the letter to the Yiddish court, he published a very similar kind of charge that Rowan was dealing in falsification and forgery, and was peddling ignorance under the guise of expertise. And he published that in the official or semi-official Vienna newspaper, the Wiener Morgenpost. That meant that Rowling either had to admit that he had committed perjury and hence had violated his oath of office as a civil servant, or he would sue Bloch for libel. He chose to sue Bloch for libel. And as the case was winding down, he removed the charge. He dismissed took back the charge, and then did the only thing that he could under the circumstances, which was to resign from his position as a professor at the University of Prague. So how different the atmosphere was is really quite remarkable, and especially given that this is over two decades after.
Well, thanks very much. We're nearly there. where is there? that's 4 minutes away. We keep the schedule religiously, right? we don't want to go too
deep.
But go ahead, you know.
Okay, I'll take a 2 minute question then. Allowing 2 minutes. I'm really struggling, as we start to think about the parallels between the presentation of the case, of the Beilis case, it strikes me that there's a way to contextualize this. We tend to contextualize this within the history of anti-Semitism. Obviously, it kind of makes sense. But, there is another way of talking about ritual murders. Serial killers, right? Who do engage in ritual behavior when they kill. And I wonder, has anyone looked at sort of putting this trial and its presentation and its rhetoric alongside other trials of serial killers in modern Russia to see what we might learn?
Quick answer, not that I'm aware of. I don't know there is. Oh, you're seeing more questions?
No.
But there's also, however, there is a book that came out in the 90s about black hundreds, and there's a chapter on the Beilis there, and there is a suggestion that there is a serial killer on the loose. Mm. And not really responsible. Mm. But it wasn't convincing to me.
But you think it was a scam?
Yeah, it's this woman in the gang, is probably what it was.
Yeah.
But that actually brings up, I think, something that is absolutely central that we keep sort of running around, and that's that this is a ritual murder, right? And we keep talking about the murder stuff, which is obviously very important, but within the context of the place and the time, it is one in which ritual was taken very seriously by a lot of people.
Right.
So the point is not so much is it a murder? It's to show the importance of ritual here, right? You know, that these are ritual acts, that these are, and ritual has meaning, right? So it's, you know, like Leonard Harris has a book about this that I don't totally agree with, but he's pretty good at talking about this, and that it seems to me that it makes the prosecution of the case makes more sense if we remember that it's a world where ritual matters. And so when you're trying to make a case for something, you know, when you're trying to get 12 people that maybe aren't so bright or maybe not all that interested in these things, it seems to me that they're more likely to accept the importance of a ritual action than they are something else. And which is another reason that it wouldn't fit with the other cases in Central or Western Europe, because it's a different kind of jury with a different sort of wheat, right? The mentality or something. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Can I go at this from another direction? Since 1878 and the negotiations of the Congress of Berlin over Article 44,
relating to a setting of the neighbor of Romania. The Russians make the argument toward the West when the question is raised, well, what about Russia and emancipating Jews? Our Jews aren't like your Jews. They're completely different.
In a more negative way.
In a more negative way, in a much more negative way. We cannot do for them what you're doing with them. In 1906, I mentioned to you, Bob, Witte, in the course of the negotiations over the Treaty of Portsmouth, right, trying to cajole Jacob Schiff into lifting the, or opening world financial markets once again toward Russia, he effectively closed off to them. And has a very frank discussion with him about the emancipation of Jews in Russia. Why does that, and Witte says, I'm with you, but I cannot convince anybody in the Russian state that our Jews aren't fundamentally different from yours and that all of the experience of Western Europe is completely irrelevant. Mm-hmm. Right? And it may very well be that this insularity is a reflection of the attempt by the Russian state to reinforce that notion that we're dealing simply with a different kind of Jew. So leave us alone.
And the response was?
What?
And the response?
The response from whom?
Schiff.
Ah, from Schiff? Schiff eventually wound up giving money to Bolsheviks.
There's a response. From the vantage point of the prosecution, who is the audience for this trial? Bob, you spoke early on and rather tentatively about, well, maybe they're trying to show how rational their state is because they're introducing evidence, the trial by jury, and all of that. You know, part of my reaction is, well, this is a weird case to make that play, and to whom are they making that play? Are they making it to the West? Now, I was thinking about the Holtquist work on the laws of war, because there you see very clearly how certain segments of the Russian state and the intelligentsia very much want to present liberal Russia to the West, and they do it by the drafting of the Geneva agreement. So, what's going on here? Is there a Western audience that, in fact, they do care about, or as they're suggesting the opposite, they really don't care about it, and it's the same to hell with you? And what segments of the state are we talking about? Obviously, we have the Justice Ministry here, but are there other segments of the state that have a different vantage point on this?
If I could add to this, I mean, to me, what's so remarkable about the entire case is that they felt they need to convince anybody of what they're accusing them of. This is already a departure in modern politics. It's already a departure. So it becomes a huge cause of labor for the legal system. Kucherov makes it this huge case for that the Russian legal system was effective. If you read his book about the Russian legal profession. But also, why does the government feel the need to go off to anyone, peasants, artisans, whatever, and convince them that there is a ritual and B, there's not a guilty? Yeah. And to me, this is the moment of mass politics. Right? To me, this is the moment where it's no longer a narrow matter of rituals, of theology and whatnot. It becomes a matter of mobilizing within and through an administrative and political system. And to me, this is what's fascinating about it. I'm afraid mine was the last word.